Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead is an absurdist play by Tom Stoppard about two minor characters from Hamlet. Very early in the story, Guildenstern is tasked with delivering a letter which he doesn't know contains his death sentence. Just before his execution, he says, "There must have been a moment at the beginning where we could have said no, but somehow we missed it. Well, we'll know better next time."
Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead.
Despite what this line suggests, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead is not really a time loop story. But I probably don't have to tell you that time loops are having a real moment right now. It's a genre that presents a world of endless time, endless chances to know better next time, so to speak. Part of why they're regaining popularity is because the world is a mess, and we either don't know how or don't have the power to fix it. But that's a really incomplete answer. There's a special dimension to modern anxiety that is making it manifest in time loop stories. In fact, they're just the most visible tip of a weird trend iceberg. But before we tackle the present, let's loop back to the past. The earliest time loop story is probably Doubled and Redoubled, written by Malcolm Jameson in 1941. In it, a man experiences one day so perfect that he wishes every day could be just like it. What an ironic wish, who could have guessed? This concept has been riffed on a lot in the decades since, like Groundhog Day, where Phil lives the same day for potentially thousands of years, to Run Lola Run, which cycles through a 20-minute loop three times until Lola figures out how to save her terrible boyfriend's terrible life. Run Lola Run was one of the inspirations for Majora's Mask. The game had to be developed in under a year, with assets reused from Ocarina of Time. So the developers focused on a small loop of events that allowed for few assets but a great depth of exploration. People who watched these movies and played Majora's Mask in their youth are now producing their own media. This happens over and over. People make stuff like the stuff that inspired them. Our culture is full of these hidden loops. Plus, themes or ideas can lie dormant until they suddenly feel relevant. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern were often cut out of productions of Hamlet, or collapsed into one person. But since Stoppard's play, they're usually preserved as tragicomic relief.
Oh, good lads.
So there are other reasons time loop stories are so big right now, which we'll get to. But first I want to talk about another big weird trend. Alternate reality stories. In her hugely influential 1997 book Hamlet on the Holodeck, Professor Janet Murray theorized that time loop and alternate reality stories have basically the same purpose. She also dared to ask, "Can games be art?" And her answer was, "Yeah."
You mean, are video games art? Oh yes, I mean, yes, of course.
Murray explains that both genres allow for an exploration of the same setting or characters or story over and over and over again. They're experimental, they allow for small variations that make big differences, and they're both particularly well-suited for interactive media.
Fiction is always an alternate reality and takes us beyond the limitation of our own lived experiences. But in a procedural and participatory medium, an interactive medium, you can make choices and you can replay the fictional experience. And that is just a really imaginatively empowering structure.
We repeat stories, highlighting aspects that feel important for that time and place. Even Shakespeare's Hamlet is based on an earlier legend. So if you're a countercultural playwright in the 1960s, you'll write absurd Hamlet. But if you're in the cowboy universe, aka Italy in the 1960s, you'll make Cowboy Hamlet.
"Hello, Horace. You look good, Johnny."
And if you're a game developer in the 2010s like Connor Fallon, you'll make Time Loop Hamlet, aka Elsinore.
There's a lot of value in telling a completely new story, but there's also a lot of value in like playing with archetypes that people have some familiar with, even if in passing. And like, for example, all the new characterization we were able to do with these characters, because by going through the time loop, you're able to see different sides of them that weren't in the original story.
In Elsinore, you can learn that Horatio harbors romantic feelings for Hamlet, stemming from a brief tryst in their past. This isn't in the original play Hamlet, but it's an interesting exploration of why Horatio is so loyal to such an asshole.
"Oh God,
time loops, and alternate reality stories are basically fanfics of themselves. Marvel, in particular, has shifted a lot of their storytelling strategy to this, like all of their current phase. This isn't a coincidence.
It is a necessary skill that we're developing in the 21st century, is running these what-if scenarios, keeping in our head multiple possibilities, keeping in our head multiple chains of causation, and multiple ways that the same scenario might play out.
The reason why this is a necessary modern skill has to do with anxiety. But before I give you anxiety, we have to talk about the third big trend that connects time loops and alternate reality stories: meta-awareness of the medium. How is that? Is that good? Okay, take. As I said, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead is not a time loop. When Guildenstern says they'll know better next time, he means at the beginning of the next performance. He's not aware he's in a time loop because he's not. He's aware that he's in a play. Marvel's alternate reality stories are grappling on a meta level with the medium of comic books. Comics used to be wholly disposable, printed on newspaper, and tossed when you were done with them. Continuity didn't matter because it couldn't matter. The way the MCU approaches comic stories, with shows and movies coexisting, was a fundamental shift in how comics were adapted. Loki is about how unwieldy comic universes are, and asks whether they should be allowed to spiral out or brought to heel. Spider-Man No Way Home is a movie about how earlier movies that weren't a part of the MCU are now also part of its canon. The What If comics have been around since the 70s, but only recently has Marvel decided to adapt them. But all video games are implicitly time loops. Time isn't linear, and as a player, you die 1,000 casual deaths without any of the intensity which squeezes out life. Time loop games are time loop games because they make that cycle explicit. The main character knows time isn't linear, that they can die 1,000 casual deaths and pop right back up at their last save state.
But then there's the contest that is part of every video game between the player and the designer. So it's like, you've set this puzzle for me, I'm gonna beat it. And if I don't beat it the first time, I'm obsessed. I'm not giving up. I'm going to keep at it. I think that part of the gaming situation is that obsessive repetition, for sure.
Players understand that this doesn't mean you're actually dead. And devs know, or hope at least, that we won't hit the first game over screen and give up. To play games is to accept this. Game over, yeah! In time loop games, this obsessive repetition stops being structural or subtextual and is just the text of the game. Time loop games inherently explore what the medium of game can do. Undertale treats having save states as a superpower, and it feels creepy to know Flowery has ogled your data, like suddenly realizing your bathroom mirror is two-way. Inscription has a boss that explicitly tells you it's going to rifle through the actual contents of your actual computer. I livestreamed the game and opted to not expose my file system to strangers on the internet, but even on my own, it was stressful to know this game was peeping my deets. This isn't the only time Inscription breaks the fourth wall, but it's the most transgressive. Because it makes you engage with the game like it's software. We rarely think of games as executable programs because it's sacrilege against immersion, the patron saint of gaming. I've made other videos about how immersion is more complicated than just having no UI, but still, a lot of modern games minimalize the game bits as much as possible. Using meta elements to call attention to the game's structure forces you, the player, to ask, "Are games art?" and then it answers it for you, "No, they're software." Now, can software be art? That's the real question. Marshall McLuhan would suggest by encountering the game's limitations as a program, the player must confront the fact that this power fantasy isn't really under their control. Consider the Stanley Parable, a game that grapples with player agency in a meta way using the looping mechanic. The canon ending is the one where you do everything exactly as the narrator says. So did you really have control? Did you choose the true ending, or just allow yourself to be funneled towards it? What does individual choice mean when we know our options are limited by invisible structures and control systems?
People are conditioned to think that there is a best outcome, right? The goal of a game is to get the best outcome for a lot of people. And we deliberately structured Elsinore so that what is the best outcome is subjective.
In Elsinore, you play as Ophelia trying to prevent your psycho ex-boyfriend from killing your dad and brother. At the end of my playthrough, I had Ophelia run away with Othello, knowing he will eventually leave her for Desdemona and that whole drama. Apparently, this specific ending was the subject of much debate among the devs.
Is this ending OP? Do we need to nerf the Othello ending? Because like, it is a thing. Like, if it was actively against our interests to have, like, an ending be too good.
In the initial release of the game, your save file was deleted after you chose your ending, because the devs wanted that choice to be final. But they got a lot of pushback. Ultimately, they updated it so you could pick a different ending, but doing so locked you out of your previous choice. You couldn't sample the world where you suffered from psychosis, and then decide you preferred it when your dad dies in exile instead. The Elsinore devs were explicitly trying to thwart the obsessive repetition by not providing a good ending. Because, you know, pretty much every version of Hamlet is still a tragedy. But they struggled with how to turn that pretty big bummer into an enjoyable game experience.
Hey, if it's just every outcome is bad, that is unsatisfying in a way. So, like, where does the power come from? Where does the satisfaction come from? It comes from the catharsis of finally being like, okay, this is a world I could live with. This is the, I'm ready to move on, right? I'm ready to, like, stop this fruitless fight to save everything and pick this outcome.
Elsinore delivers on the meta promise of time loops by exploring what it means to have a bunch of potential realities, and therefore potential endings. As an exception, it points to the reason why so many time loop games have single canon endings, and why we have so many time loop games to begin with.
We have this exponential increase in the what if, and I think that we are developing this cognitive ability to see these parallel tracks rather than just seeing one story.
The reason why we're developing this ability now is because of how anxiety interacts with social media. That's right, it's finally time to talk about anxiety. The human phenomenon of obsessively consuming bad news long predates the internet. It's a defensive behavior our brains develop to keep us safe. If you're stressed out, you might become anxious to mitigate whatever danger your brain perceives you're in. Even if you're not in danger, that anxiety drive sometimes insists that you are, and that there is a piece of information that's going to save your life. But you can never know what that information is, so you have to keep searching endlessly forever. If you have any proclivity towards that kind of thinking, the worst thing you can do is have unfettered access to an unlimited source of bad news. Uh-oh. In the early days of the pandemic, this behavior was codified as doomscrolling. Social media is a matter of quantity, not quality. Whatever feed you prefer, it's meant to be a one-stop, non-stop place for news and community, for advice and family updates and jokes and mourning. And ads, mostly. But there's no easy way to cordon off bad news so that you can engage with it when you're in the right headspace to receive information that could hurt you. Social media also gives us easy access to somebody who believes something that is fundamentally anathema to our entire worldview. Everything from "Am I the asshole?" to Twitter's main character of the day to some unbelievable viral cooking video. Every day you have to engage with beliefs and behaviors so disconnected from your perception of reality that you probably think they come from a different world altogether. I'm not being metaphorical here. We are being forced to, and also seeking out opportunities to, interact with versions of the world that seem unthinkable to us. And that can be really stressful. It makes you rethink everything you thought you knew about the world a dozen times a day. We now perceive tragedy as inevitable and life-ruining. The original time loop story was about a guy who had a perfect day and then had to repeat it until it lost all its charm, that poor sap. By contrast, a lot of more recent time loops prominently feature the main characters dying at the end of their first loop, That's right, the story written in the middle of World War II is more optimistic than modern versions.
View alternate futures to see all the possible outcomes of the coming conflict.
How many did you see?
14,605.
How many did we win?
One.
And time loops are about how tragedy is inevitable. Unless you can gather enough information to divert it. They imagine a world where the unlimited consumption of information is the best, sometimes only power you have to stop disaster. And finally, you have enough time to learn every factor that might cause your downfall.
And I think that one of the things that is a response we know to past trauma is just you repeat and repeat and repeat, and how this is the plot of a lot of time loop video games, is how do we avoid a disaster? Let's go back over it. We weren't prepared.
Perhaps ironically, I was way more worried about this supercharged anxiety trend than Murray, who told me that seeking out parallel realities was just part of the growing pains of the modern age.
That's also an adaptive skill, because that's how we learn to build bridges differently and to build societies differently. I do think that it's anxiety fuels that kind of obsessive repetition. I understand what you mean, but I think it's adaptive.
She convinced me. Time loop and alternate reality stories let us practice these parallel tracks. They help us understand that the world is not one unified reality to which we all subscribe. It's both a power fantasy and a defense strategy. Media can either comfort you or challenge you. Neither strategy is inherently better. In Majora's Mask, the Cafe Anju quest has three different branches that directly conflict. You can't complete them all in one loop. But in the credits, you still get to see all those people living out their completed quest lives. It's not possible within the logic of the game. That's the power fantasy, that you can have a perfect loop, that you can save everyone. Other time loops embrace tragedy, which is also good because tragedy teaches us that control is an illusion.
What would your life be like under different circumstances? We're very aware of that. And aware of the fact that life doesn't have a one win.
Falsehood of perfectionism, right? And like, if you continue to just look for the perfect ending, that's not a thing that exists in the real world. There is no perfect ending for us.
This is why Elsinore labels its endings as sacrifices. They're about compromising to find a way through.
When you're faced with a difficult situation, the only power we have is to act as wisely as we can with the information that we have. And that choice is a power, even if the thing you're choosing isn't perfect.
Another facet of modern life is the increasing cultural awareness of all these invisible structures and systems of power that are manipulating and limiting us. Everything from algorithms that favor negative news, to gerrymandering and voter suppression, to companies controlling the type of content allowed on their platforms. But even when we know our options are limited by these systems, we do still have some amount of power, of choice. Even if there are only two hallways, you still choose which one to walk down, or you choose to walk away. This is motivating the meta aspect of these stories. They demonstrate and play with the structures that have defined their mediums. Save states are really important, but we take them for granted. What happens if we highlight them? What if we disobey the narrator? What if the rules themselves are unfair? And these two are adaptive growing pains. You have to learn to recognize bad systems before you can fix them. Time loop games and alternate realities are struggling to bridge two worlds. In one, the wide, beautiful, terrifying variety of possibilities are collapsed down into one single agreed upon reality, the correct interpretation, the canon end. In the other, we have to maintain multiple understandings of the world. And it takes a lot more effort, but we get to choose for ourselves what the right way forward is. At the end of Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead, Guildenstern thinks back to the messenger and says, "There must have been a moment in the beginning where we could have said no. Somehow we missed it." Well, we'll know better next time. But they don't. Those summons come before the first scene of the play, so they never have a chance to replay and change them. their tragedy is inevitable because it was written that way. But we're not characters protected by or trapped in a loop. The world is changing. We can and must adapt new strategies for living that make sure we're not miserable all the time. As for entertaining ourselves, that probably means more time loop and alternate reality stories. What else it can mean? Well, time will tell.